Last week we looked at inputs to control systems, step, ramp, and pulse, and we had a particular focus on the response in the time domain for first order systems. And then we just had a small discussion about final value theorem and how to determine the steady state value that you have as time tends to infinity. Well, this week we're going to continue that discussion, but looking at second order time response for second order systems. Now, it's worthwhile to look at the time response for second order systems because many systems, physical systems, that would normally have a higher order than second order can actually be well represented by a second order system. And because of this focus on second order systems, the tools and methods that we will use to analyse the response are very well developed. We'll now return to the lecture. Second order systems in general are characterised by two terms. This term zeta is the damping ratio, and then we've got omega n, which is known as the natural frequency. And all second order systems will consist of these two variables, and often the behaviour of the system will be defined by the values for these two variables. And so, second order system, this is the standard form for a second order system when we are looking at developing transfer functions where you have a one term in the denominator. The other alternative form is if you multiply this equation by omega n squared over omega n squared, so you multiply it by 1. Obviously, it disappears from here. You get an omega n up in here. This turns into omega n squared, and this turns into omega n squared, which is this form here. And this is the standard form that we're going to use from now on, okay, in terms of second order systems. And notice that we've got an omega n squared in the numerator as well as in the denominator, okay? And you can see that these two terms, there's zeta and there's omega n, okay? And so the whole system is going to behave depending on these two terms. And what we're going to look at today is the time response for a second order system and the various characteristics or the properties that that time response possesses. And your tutorial sheet that's already on Blackboard will give you you've got a whole bunch of transfer functions, and from that you need to determine all the various different characteristics of that time response from the equations. Okay. But I'll start off by giving you some graphical representation and what those various parameters mean, and then we're going to go through an example of a mass spring damper, which is a generic second order system, and we're going to find the different values for the various characteristics of that response. So there's our second order system. So that was the equation I just had on the previous slide. And what I'm going to do is I'm just going to give you the standard form for the time response, okay, which is in response to a step response. And this is with a gain of 1. Okay, I'm not going to go through the maths to go from that to this. But this is the response, unit step response in unity gain. Okay, and this will be on your equation sheet, so you don't need to worry too much about remembering it. But what we've got is, with a unit step response, obviously you have a step that goes up to 1 and then levels off. And so we've got 1 as the thing, and then minus, and then this is some exponential term, and this you can see quite obviously is some form of sinusoid with various different parameters. Okay, we've got a sine and a cosine in there, and various different constants. And as you can see, this is an exponential to a minus sign, so it's going to be decaying. And so you can see that what will happen is that as time increases, there's a T here, and a T here. Well, those are just to do with the sinusoid, but as time increases, obviously this will go to e to the minus infinity, and e to the minus infinity is 0. And so as time increases, this exponential will slowly decay, and so that sinusoid will slowly decay, and you'll end up with just your final value, which is 1. Okay? And so that's the form of it. Basically, you've got a sinusoid and a decaying exponential term. And omega d, notice that we've come across omega n before. Okay, that's the natural frequency. This is known as the damped natural frequency. Because if you've got damping in the system, then you have an omega d value. And omega d is basically the natural frequency times 1 minus the damping coefficient. Sorry, damping ratio squared. Okay, and if the damping ratio is 0, obviously this is going to be omega n times by 1. And so your omega n is just the natural frequency. Whereas if you've got damping, you've got a damped natural frequency, which is generally less than your natural frequency. But we'll talk a little bit more about damping ratio in a second. And so if you took, put some generic values into that, and the response could look something like this. Okay, so here's our 0 point. And we come along, our demand goes up to 1 and then along, straight along. Okay, and what the response will do is it will start to oscillate. Okay, we overshoot our demand, we start oscillating, but as you can see, the oscillation decays. And these envelopes are the exponential times. Okay, and so if I point out the various things, so this is time response for an underdamped system. We'll talk about what we mean by underdamped in a second. So this line, obviously the solid line, is going to be our response that I showed you on the previous slide. So we've got our 1 minus the exponential, the decaying exponential, so that's these envelopes. And then this is the sinusoid signal that you see here, the oscillation, okay, with a frequency of the damped natural frequency. And so, like I said, the envelopes, that's 1 plus e to the minus zeta omega nt. And obviously the one below it is going to be 1 minus e to the minus zeta omega nt. Okay, and so that envelope will, the response will be within that envelope of those two things. Okay. Now, I talked a little bit about what this damped natural frequency is. Well, that's the frequency of oscillation, okay? And what I've got here is the period. The period is obviously 2 pi divided by your omega. And that's the time that it takes for one oscillation. And that's constant. It doesn't matter the amplitude, okay? The period there is the same as the period over here, okay? It doesn't change as the oscillation dies away, okay? It doesn't make any difference. But it's not the natural frequency, it's the damped natural frequency, which is omega d. Now, I said this is an underdamped system. Well, that depends upon this value for zeta, the damping ratio. Okay, and what I've got here is a whole bunch of different zetas for the same system, but with different zeta values. And what you have is a whole different sorts of response. Okay. The increasing zeta goes this way, okay? So if the zeta is low, then you get an oscillatory response, and as you increase zeta, you go past this point, which is zeta equals 1, and I'll talk about that in a second, to this situation where there's no oscillation, and it takes a long time to reach the value, okay? On this side, it's called underdamped. This is critical, and this is overdamped. And we'll discuss the characteristics of that. And so if I mark out underdamped, zeta is less than 1. Okay, and so you've got these responses here where essentially each of these will overshoot your demand value of 1. Okay, you can see that this overshoots obviously by a long way, and this one just overshoots a little bit here before settling. Okay, if you have overdamped systems, then obviously there's no overshoot and you just take a long time, depending on your value. You've got a large value for 1, so say this, I don't know what the value was for this one, but let's say it's 4, then it's going to take a long time to actually reach the value, and it will never overshoot. Okay, and between the two, there's a critical value for zeta, and that's when zeta equals 1, which gives you the fastest response to your final value, but with no overshoot. Okay, often systems will be underdamped, okay, in the way they respond, because obviously the big advantage of an underdamped system is that you get even faster response than critical, okay? And so if you can put up with a 10% overshoot or something, then it's actually better to, instead of being critically damped, to actually have a bit of underdamping, because you get to the final point quicker. And if you can tolerate a little bit of overshoot, then all the better, okay? And often systems, there'll be a bit of overshoot built in. And so we've got underdamped systems where zeta is less than 1, okay, and this is what we're going to focus on more today. We'll talk a little bit about what happens here, but not too much. But underdamped systems, because this is what represents real life, in a sense. Most systems are underdamped. And you get some element of oscillation in the response. You get it'll be oscillate a little bit. Okay, and if zeta is 0, there's no damping in the system, okay, then your system will, you fire it up, the system will continue to oscillate forever. Okay, it won't die down. The exponential term will just be equal to 1, okay? because it will be e to the power of 0, and e to the power of 0 is 1. And so that sinusoid term in the response won't die away. And so you just get some sustained oscillation of a particular frequency. If z3 equals 1, you get what's known as critical damping, and that's the fastest response with no overshoot, which is the red line on the graph. And that represents the boundary between underdamped and overdamped. And then if you've got a situation where z3 is greater than 1, then you have an overdamped system, and the system simply can't overshoot. But obviously the downside of that is it takes a long time to reach your destination. Okay? And the greater the zeta value, the longer it will take to get there. So here's a time response. Okay, there's just some random one that I've dreamt up. Okay, and you can see that it overshoots slightly, and there's a complete oscillation, perhaps a bit over one oscillation. Okay, and then it settles on the demand value, which in this case is 1. Now, there are a few features of this system that we can determine from the equation. Okay, and that equation, obviously, like I said, involves zeta and omega n, and by consequence, omega d. Okay, and that based on those values, we can make some judgments and some calculations based on those values to represent this equation. And so these are I've called performance criteria. The first one is what we call the rise time, okay, and that is the time it takes from 0 to obviously TR, which is the rise time, for the system to reach your starting point to your steady state value. Okay, and obviously that's if you overshoot, then you're going to meet your steady state value. If you've got a system where you're overdamped, then you don't have in a sense you almost never reach your steady state value because there's that decaying exponential. You'll get closer and closer, and so we determine the rise time an overdamped system to be between 10% and 90%. So when you get from 10% to the final value to 90%, and then that's considered to be your rise time. Because if you've got an overdamped system, then not only does it not overshoot, but you also have a slow start off as well. Okay. So we determine the rise time for an overdamped system to go from 10% to 90% amplitude. Okay. Obviously, for an underdamped system, you're going to overshoot. So it's the time at which it crosses over that overshoot time. Peak time, okay, well, that's the time it takes for it to reach a maximum amplitude of overshoot, okay, and that's denoted by TP. And the peak overshoot, okay, well, that's going to be, this is in terms of time, obviously, this is in terms of amplitude, and that's the amount above your steady state value, which is obviously our final value here, okay, that the overshoot reaches. And so that's y, because y is a function of time, and we put TP in there, and you're going to get a value that's the overshoot value. Okay. Settling time, okay, well, we define settling time as the time for the response to settle within some band around your final value, okay, and often the value that's used is plus or minus 5%, so obviously here we're 95% of the value, and this is 105% of the value. And it's once you reach that point, okay, any response beyond that will be within that band, okay? And so we're using the 5% settling time, and in this case, that's this point here, which is our settling time, 5% settling time. Obviously, if we had a 2% settling time, then we'd be further along, because that would be the point at which your response is within 2% of the final value. And 1% settling time, and so on. There's different criteria. We'll generally use the 5% settling time because that's good enough. If we're within 5% of our final value, that's pretty good going. And of course, the last performance criteria is the number of oscillations before you reach this point. Okay, so in this case, we've got, if you imagine this is the trough of a cosine, okay, or sinusoid, okay, then you reach a peak, and then there's another trough, and so there's one oscillation from there to there, and then we've got a bit more of one oscillation. So in this case, we've got just over one oscillation before you reach the settling time, TS. So how do we calculate these various things? Well, the rise time, okay, is by setting your response to be 1, or your final value, okay. And then you've got to do loads and loads of manipulation. You know, you've got that long equation with exponentials to the power of something times t. You've got your sinusoids with t in. You do lots of maths. I'm not going to bore you with it. But you end up getting this as your equation. Okay, and so you've got 1 over omega d times by pi minus the inverse tan of 1 minus zeta squared square rooted over zeta. And you get a value in terms of seconds, okay, which will be the rise time for your system. Now, this is for an underdamped system. Okay, and like I said, we're going to focus mostly on underdamped systems. So this is for an underdamped system, and this is the rise time. Okay. Now, on your tutorial sheet, you'll get this equation, so you don't need to worry too much about having to remember it. And so you can see quite simply that if you've got a low damping ratio, so if this value is small, okay, you get a faster response, because you're going to get a tangent of infinity, and tangent of infinity is pi, and so you get pi minus pi. And so you end up with a very very quick response, because that whatever's in that bracket will be very small. But the issue that you get is you end up with an oscillatory response. And so a compromise in the value for zeta is often necessary, and you know, a good start is somewhere between 0.4 and 0.8. 0.6 is obviously quite a good start as well. So the other thing is the time to peak. Okay, well, that's from inspection. For an oscillatory system, is the time to peak is one half of the periodic response. Okay, and so you take your periodic response. So there was our period, if you remember, was 2 pi over omega d. Well, obviously half of that, the 2's cancel, you end up with pi over omega d. But hold on a second, well, you know, let me just go back to the response and you'll see what I mean. So as I said, with this system, you've got an oscillation. This is a trough of a cosine, or a sinusoid, okay, and this is the peak, and then there's the trough. Okay, and so the time to the peak, okay, is obviously going to be one half of your period. Okay, the period, like I said, was here. For one oscillation, well, half of it is the peak. And so that's where that comes from. But the other way to find it is to do it mathematically. You can go through, and we all know from school math that you can find the maxima of a curve by taking the derivative and setting the derivative to zero. Because obviously when the slope of a curve is zero, then we know we've reached a maxima or a minima of a parabola or whatever it was you're looking at. So if you set the derivative of that response to zero, you get this is one of your solutions. Okay, and one of the solutions happens to be your peak point. Obviously, there's going to be more than one solution. There'll be one solution at zero, and there'll be solutions wherever you've got this oscillation changing direction. Okay, but the first one that's not zero will be your peak oscillation. And so that's pi divided by the damped natural frequency. Peak overshoot, well, we use that value for Tp, and we stick that into our equation, and then you evaluate the equation. And so there's our equation. And instead of t now, I've got tp, which is our peak value. And so you bung that value in and you solve the equation, because we know these various things from the transfer function. I'll talk about that in a second. And you get a value which will be your peak value. Okay, and that's the absolute peak value. Obviously, the amount over your thing you need to subtract your steady state value from. And so the percentage maximum peak value, well, you take your peak value, you subtract the steady state, and then you divide it by the steady state value, and you end up getting some value in percentage. So you multiply by 100 to get the percentage. Okay, and so say I've got 16% overshoot or 18% overshoot. Well, that's how you calculate the overshoot in terms of percentage. And this is a standard method to calculate percentages. Obviously, this can also be seen as YTP over YSS minus 1. Okay, but obviously that's the same thing. If you put YSS here, and the YSS here, and separated the fractions, obviously YSS over YSS is 1. And so that's the other way you may see it. This is the way I've written it, because it matches my description over there. Then we have settling time. Well, settling time is that TS, okay? And the way we work out settling time is we just take that exponential, that decaying exponential. And when that is less than 5% or 0.05, okay, then obviously you're within that 5% of your final value, because that that exponential will die away with respect to where the final value is going to be. Okay, and so you take this term, okay, and you equate to 0.05, giving the 5% second time, and then you solve for t. Okay, there is tp, that should really probably be ts. It's ts down here. So you set that equal to 5%, okay, and then obviously you take the natural log of this side and the natural log of this side. Well, the natural log of this side will just give you this term, the minus zeta omega nts. And you take the natural log of 0.05 and you get minus 3. Well, obviously the minus signs can drop from there. And so the 5%, if you take Ts on its own, we divide both sides by zeta omega n, you get the settling time is 3 divided by zeta omega n. And that gives you this 5% settling time for your system. And obviously, if you wanted to calculate the 2% settling time, you'd start off here, but it would be 0.02. And you'd go through the motions and you get a value for some value divided by zeta omega n. 1% settling time and so on. Okay, that's the way to calculate settling time. And that, like I said, because that exponential term represents the envelope, okay, that the oscillations will die down in. And then lastly, the number of oscillations before settling time. Well, you just take the settling time and you divide it by the periodic time, and that will give you, because this periodic time is going to represent the frequency of the oscillation. So the settling time divided by the periodic time will give you the number of oscillations, and that could be some fraction of some number, decimal, whatever. So perhaps the best way to look at this is to look at an example. Okay, and so I've got a classical mass spring damper system where you've got a spring of constant K, you've got your damper of constant C, okay, we've got a mass of M that's moving in the X direction. X is positive to the right-hand side, and there's a force being applied, F of T, okay? And that force represents our input, be that a step or ramp or sinusoid or whatever, okay? And so let's put some values to this. Our mass is 1 kilogram. We've got a spring coefficient of 4 newtons per meter, so that's our K value, and a damping coefficient of 2 newton seconds per meter, so that's our value for C. And so if you go through the motions that you did in the first couple of weeks of this course, you will end up getting a transfer function for this system. Okay, so G of S is obviously this in the S domain divided by the force in the S domain. That's our transfer function because this is our input, this is the output. And this is in one form, okay? That should be a 1, by the way. No, I can't remember. What's going on here? That's not right. Okay, but anyway, you multiply through by n, and you get this. Yes, okay, so that's fine. Yes, that is correct. Because n is 1, obviously, when you multiply through by n, this is 1 times s squared. And so you end up with this as your transfer function. And this is in the standard form that we're looking at, okay? And so we can go through and we can determine various things. Well, we know that this term here is omega n squared. Okay, so to get omega n, you take the square root of 4 and you get 2. Nice and simple. This term, 1/2, okay, well, there's a couple of ways you can calculate that. One way is you know that this 2 value has to equal 2 zeta omega n, okay, because if you went back to the original form, you'll see that, for those of you with the slides, the original form's on slide 3, you saw that this term here was a 2 zeta omega n. Let me see if the pen's working. I can write it. I don't know whether this is going to work. We know that the middle thing, 2 zeta omega n. Okay? Well, if we know omega n is 2, and then we've got a 2 here already, okay, so this term must be 1/2 for that term to equal 2. Yeah, this equals, in this case, equals 2. And so if this term is 2, and this term obviously is 2, then this must be 1/2 for that whole thing to equal 2. Okay, so that's where that 1/2 comes from. And then omega d is you calculate from these two values. You have omega n minus 1 minus zeta squared. Well, 1/2 squared is 1/4. 1 minus 1/4 is 3/4, so you end up with 2 times 3/4. And obviously the 4 can come out because the square root of 4 is 2, so you end up with 2 over 2, which is 1, and you're just left with root 3. And so the damped natural frequency is root 3 radians per second, but our natural frequency is 2 radians per second. Root 3 is less than 2. Okay. And our, like I said, our damping ratio is zeta. Let's assume we're going to put a unit step input, so that's, we know what that is, that's R over, that's A, 1 over S. So here's our transfer function. Now, this is not quite in the standard form. If you remember, the standard form was omega m squared divided by S squared plus 2 zeta omega n plus omega n squared, okay? And what do you notice about that term? Well, this omega n term, this last term on the denominator, must equal the term on top for that response to work. Whereas in this case, obviously, we've got a 1 on top and a 4 on the bottom. And so what we need to do is we need to multiply this transfer function by 1 over 4, a quarter, and then we can put a 4 on the top. So to put it in standard form, the numerator must equal omega n squared, so we multiply by a quarter. And so what you do is you put a quarter there, and you put whatever's on the bottom down here up there, because obviously to get back to that, you would cancel those two terms and you end up with the original. So it's the same thing, but we've added an extra term in so that this term can equal that term. That's just a standard method. And so this bit is your standard response. And your standard response is, in this case, is just going to be multiplied by a quarter. And so our standard response, we've got our various terms. Okay, they're there. Let me get rid of that picture because you now can't see it. So those are what we calculated before. Omega n, zeta, and omega d. And so our standard response, you stick in those values for where they were represented in the final thing, and you end up with this equation. The whole thing multiplied by a quarter, because that quarter is a constant, doesn't change with time, so you just multiply the whole response by a quarter. Okay? And so there's our response. And so if you plotted this equation, you'd get the response that you get for this system. Which I haven't done, so I don't believe. Oh, I have done that at the end. Okay. So this is the response you get. And so we can go through and work out the various things. Now that we've got these values, periodic time, well, that's 2 pi over omega d, so that's 2 pi over root 3, so 3.628 seconds is our periodic time. Okay, so that's the frequency of oscillation. Every 3.628 seconds, you're going to get one oscillation. The rise time, well, we use our equation that we got, okay? You bung in the numbers, and you solve for it, you get the rise time. It takes 1.2 seconds for it to reach zero to your settling time, the final value. Time to peak, well, we said that was 1/2 the periodic time. So you take your periodic time, you divide it by 2, and you get this value. Although that's not quite divided by 2, is it? Interesting. Okay. I think this must be a 1. Okay, so you get your periodic time. Peak overshoot. Okay, well, you apply that peak time to your equation. And so you bung this 1.804 in. Like I said, there might be a 1 in there. And you end up getting 0.291 as your periodic, as the time to get to the peak, okay? The amplitude of the peak value, not the time to get to it. The time to get to it is TP. You put that in here and you get the amplitude of your peak value, okay? And the percentage increase is you take this value, you subtract your steady state value, which in this case was 0.25 because that's represented by the quarter, you divide it by the quarter, and you get a percentage increase, in this case, of 16%. And so we know the overshoot is 16%. And the 5% second time, again, you just use the equation that we developed, and you get 3 seconds. Obviously, 0.5 times 2 is 1, 3 divided by 1 is 3. And so 3 seconds is second time. And so if you looked, and the number of oscillations, in this case, we've got 0.827. Because you take the setting time over the periodic time, and we're within one period we are settled. Okay, so if we took the response, so here's the response. Okay, and so we've got the various things. There's our rise time of 1.209. Then we've got the peak time, which is matching this point here, which is 1.804. Our settling time, we know, is 3 seconds. Okay, and so from this point, we know that we're within 5%, because from that point onwards, okay, it doesn't go beyond 5%. And the periodic time in this case is 3.628, okay, so that's obviously for one oscillation, okay, and you can see that that's greater than where the settling time was. And so our peak overshoot, which is obviously this, in the amplitude sense, is 0.291, okay, so we're up here, and that matches this value for the peak time, okay. And that's our 16% overshoot. So there's the response for the system, and from the mathematics behind it, we can calculate all these different values, okay, just by knowing those two terms, the zeta and the omega n term, and consequently the omega d term. So, as a summary, we looked at the step response of second order systems, okay, and we have the equation for that. Second order systems are really useful because they can be used to represent many higher order systems, and like I said, later on in this course you'll be designing controllers that will make, you know, say a third order or a fourth order system to be second order dominant, in which case you can ignore the higher order bits and the system will respond like a second order system. The response is defined by these two terms, the natural frequency omega n and the damping ratio. And the damped natural frequency you can get from those two values, okay? And so your response is going to be defined by those two things. And they're shown up in the transfer function. You can generally find those values from there. The damping ratio relates to the oscillation and the response, okay? So obviously, a large damping ratio, you've got no oscillation. A low damping ratio, less than one, you're going to have some oscillation. And that relates to the oscillation. And obviously, because that affects your damped natural frequency, it also affects the frequency of the oscillation. And the performance criteria that we looked at rise time, peak time and amplitude, and the settling time, and then there was the various other things, number of oscillations being one of them, and the periodic time, which we can calculate. And so, tutorial sheet 4, this is what we're up to now, and this is essentially a set of problems, and fortunately we've got enough time to do one of them, so I'm going to do one of them. There's a set of problems where I'm giving you the transfer function and we've got to work out various values, okay? And so so if you don't mind, we can go through one and that will give you an idea of where to start. Okay, so I'll zoom in a bit. So the first problem on the tutorial sheet, am I within? I've given you the same one that we used in the lecture, s squared plus 2s plus 4. Okay? But this time we've got a step input of 3. And so we know that r of s is 3 upon s, as we discovered last week. Okay? So there's the problem. And from this we need to find the equation for the time response, the natural frequency, damping ratio, and that damped natural frequency, final value, so we're using the final value theorem again this week. Periodic time, the rise time, peak time, magnitude, 5% settling time, and the number of oscillations before settling. And on the back of the formula sheet, on the back of the tutorial sheet, there's a whole bunch of formulae, okay? And so there's our time response. There's the transfer function, there's the time response, there's the equation for omega d. Okay, and then these are the equations from the lecture that we discussed to get the various things. And then right at the bottom, I've covered what happens if zeta is greater than 1, which we haven't talked about in the lecture, but there is one question on the tutorial sheet where zeta is greater than 1. Obviously, if zeta is greater than 1, then things like the rise time is slightly different, okay? But obviously, your periodic time, there is no periodic time, whatever that is, okay? Peak time, well, it doesn't reach a peak. Your peak is your final value. Okay, settling time, well, that's within 5% of the final value, so you can work that out. And obviously that doesn't matter as well, because because there's no oscillations, a whole bunch of this stuff doesn't matter. Okay, so we've got our question. Zoom out just a touch. And so what we do is we take the... Again, we want omega n squared to be on the top again, so we do the same thing. We can say that Gs is 1/4 of 4 over s squared plus 2s plus 4. Okay, and so we can make the same judgments about the various values. Omega n is the square root of 4, which equals 2 radians per second. Zeta, okay, well, like I said, this value here, that's 2 zeta omega n, which equals 2. Okay, so if we've got 2 zeta times 2 equals 2, then one of those 2's cancel, so zeta must equal 1 over 2. So that's 1/2. There's no units for zeta, it's a ratio, okay? And we know that omega d is going to be omega n times the square root of 1 minus zeta squared. And so we've got 2 times by 3/4. That comes out, so we end up with root 3. And so for part A was find the formula, or you just apply the formula. C over T. Don't forget the quarter. Equals 1 divided by 4 multiplied by 1 minus e to the power of minus zeta omega n t. So we've got zeta, which is 1/2, omega n, which is 2 times by t. Then we've got zeta, which is 1/2, omega n over omega d, so that's 2 over root 3, sine omega d t plus the cosine of omega d t. Okay. Obviously the 2's here can cancel, and I'll put the 1/4 through, okay? E to the minus t, because they cancel with that, okay? Then here we've got those 2 cancel, so we end up with 1 over root 3 sine root 3 t plus cosine root 3 t. That's the answer. But we've forgotten, this is the answer for the 1/4, we've forgotten the step input is 3. And so we have to multiply this whole thing by 3. Okay? And so instead of that being 1 there, so this should all be multiplied by 3, going to the step input, multiply this whole thing by 3, and we end up with this being 3/4 minus 3/4 e to the minus t 1 over root 3. Sine root 3 t plus cosine root 3 t. Okay? Because of the input being 3, obviously you multiply the output by 3 and you get some more value. So that's part A. Part B. Well, we've got those values here. Okay, so there's part B. I'll ask for those values. So that's part B. See above. Part C was applying the final value theorem. Well, we know that the final value theorem we did last week is the limit as s goes to 0 of s times c of s. Okay, well, the c of s we know is going to be g of s times r of s. So that's going to be s times 3 of s over 1 over s squared plus 2s plus 4. Okay. Well, that s cancels with that s. Okay, and as s goes to 0, that disappears and that disappears, so we end up with 3 over 4, 3 quarters. Okay, and that matches with our final value, because obviously as t goes to infinity, which is what we mean by s going to 0, as this goes to infinity, this term drops to 0. And so we end up with 3 quarters minus 3 quarters times 0 times some sinusoid. Well, anything multiplied by 0 is 0, and so our final value is that. And that's proved here. Okay. Those two terms cancel, this turns to 0, this turns to 0, and 3 times 1 over 4 is 3 quarters. Okay, so it's the same thing. So that's the final value theorem. D, periodic time. Okay, well that's simply the period, it's 2 pi over omega d. And so the answer is 2 pi over root 3, which is 3.628 seconds. E, rise time. TR, we apply our funky equation that we've got. 1 over omega d, pi minus inverse tan of 1 minus zeta squared over zeta. You plug it in, 1 over root 3 pi minus tan minus 1 of root 3 quarters over over 1 half. And we get 1.209 seconds. So that's the rise time. F asks for the peak time, but it's 1 half the period, so Tp is 1 half times by 2 pi divided by omega d. That's 2 pi, there's that, okay, 1 half of that is obviously going to be pi over root 3, which comes out to be 1.814 seconds. That's right now. And the peak amplitude, okay, well, we plug that time into our equation. And so CTP is 3 over 4 minus 3 over 4 e to the minus 1.814, 1 over root 3 sine root 3 times by 1.814 plus cosine root 3 times 1.814. And that, if you do the sums, comes out to be 0.872, being the final value. G is the settling time. Ts. Well, we know that the 5% settling time is 3 over zeta omega n, and so that's going to be 3 over 1, which equals 3 seconds. And h is the number of oscillations, which we know is ts over period, and so that's 3 divided by 3.628, which equals 0.827. And so we started out with the equation, which is just simply a matter of plugging in those values for omega n, omega d, and zeta, okay, which is there. And because our input this time wasn't a unit step, it's a step of some value, we just multiply the equation by that value. For the values for omega n and zeta and omega z, well, you had to find them to use the equation. So I've just put c above because we've got them. For the final value theorem, we know that c of infinity in the time domain is the limit as s goes to 0 in the s domain of s times your final equation in the s domain. And so you plug in your transfer function and your inputs multiplied by s, and you end up getting 3 quarters as the final value. You could also find the final value obviously from our time domain equation. periodic time, okay, well that's 2 pi over the damped natural frequency, and so we end up with 3.628 seconds. Rise time, well this is the equation that we got in the lecture, and you plug in the values for omega d and zeta, okay, and you get your final value of 1.209. Peak time is one half of our periodic time, well the periodic time is 3.628 seconds, so this must be 1.814 seconds, okay, it's half of 3.628. And to get the amplitude at the peak time, you plug it into our equation up there. Okay, so instead of t, we've got 1.814. You plug it in, you get a value of 0.872. So that's the peak amplitude. Okay, and obviously that's the final value we know is 0.75, 3/4. And that goes above the final value by some okay value. And then the settling time, well, it's 3 over zeta omega n. Again, it's just applying the equation. Zeta is a half, omega n is 2. Half times 2 is 1, so you get 3 over 1, which is 3. And the number of oscillations, you get Ts over the period, so that's 3 over 3.628. You get 0.827 oscillations. Okay, is that clear? Yeah? And so the rest of the tutorial sheet looks just like that. Okay, here it is. And so there's a whole bunch of different transfer functions down here that you have to work out those various terms for, and then right at the end there's a little exercise, what's the equation for the 2% settling time and the 1% settling time, okay, and like I said